here with Marc Merrill, co-founder and co-CEO of Riot Games. Thank you, Marc.
Thanks for having me.
For being here. You started as a co-founder, and the first game was issued in 2009, and now you're up to about 2,500 employees spread all over the world. How do you morph as a leader from being the founder gamer with your partner and now running a big enterprise?
Well, it's a huge challenge, and I'm sure many leaders have gone through the need to kind of reinvent themselves over and over as the circumstances require different styles of leadership. And I think any founder who has scaled an organization has experienced those types of challenges because one of the things that we talked about a lot was the need to replace yourself constantly. So, and it wasn't just for my partner and myself who were running the firm, where originally we were leading a product development team and then taking a product to market, but eventually over time, rather than just leading a team directly, we had to lead managers of managers who were then managing other managers and training them. And I think it's really important to have a growth mindset and be able to learn and adapt and not get married to any particular one way of doing things while being able to focus on solving the most important problems of the day. And because those are very dynamic and constantly changing, we've been tremendously blessed to have a great relationship with my business partner. So we can each sort of morph or adapt and support each other based on the changing nature of the business. But I'll tell you, it does require a very different skill set for managing a small team to managing a large organization with 20 offices across the world.
Just follow up on that question. You were fantastic as a founder with an idea and getting that to market. But how did you know that you could, in fact, adjust to this next stage? And how did you learn as you went along?
Well, we didn't know. And, I think being honest with yourself about that is an important step. My partner and I both, when we first decided to take on venture capital, we asked ourselves and sort of made the commitment that if we thought anybody was going to be better at us at the jobs that we currently had, then we should be very willing to step aside. And I think that mindset helped drive the learning that was necessary throughout the stages where we were very comfortable being open and honest about what we knew or what we didn't know. And involving other people, whether at the company or outside parties, is necessary to help bring in skill sets to augment whatever gaps we thought we had or what the company needed to go achieve. And, we made a lot of mistakes, especially big mistakes early on. But those mistakes, I think, helped teach us some lessons that allowed us to potentially avoid even bigger mistakes later on. So I think, continuing to learn and try to find different ways to absorb whatever lessons you need to actually learn to move forward is something we really tried to focus on.
The rapid change in the company's size was also matched by the reach. It's a global company. It's Europe and especially China. How do you manage differently those kinds of constituencies with that reach that fast?
Yeah, so the international aspect adds a whole new dimension to the business, which complicates things greatly. So part of that is about getting, just like with any particular business problem, we think getting the right people is incredibly important. So being clear about what criteria you're looking for based on what you think is necessary for the conditions of the market or that business in order to be successful. So having a great hiring process, great selection process, very important, as well as talent management internally, as well as various organizational practices to really know who's responsible for what and who makes what decisions. Because great people don't want to come work for a company where they're not going to be empowered to go drive change. But similarly, they also want to be part of an organization that has strong vision and a great strategy and knows where it's going as well. And so striking the balance has been important to be able to be successful in different markets. So a market like China or Korea, and the differences between, say, Europe and North America do require some degree of regional autonomy, where the way that you get into the game or different aspects of the business model or how it's positioned in the market, et cetera, can change pretty significantly. Whereas the game itself or things that must be universal, like our brand or our values, et cetera, we centralize those. But nonetheless, even if we centralize something, we still empower the local team to do it their way. And again, just like I was talking about learning earlier, we learn together as a team. And so we try to share best practices in a way that you know, almost like a government ideally would, between sort of the federal level and the state level. We have dynamics called central and local, and we try to share a lot of knowledge across those groups to continue for the organization to have institutional learning.
How do you keep the spirit of innovation going? I mean, in a sense, you're now incumbents. Mm-hmm. You're very successful. And there could be two guys called Mark and Brandon who come around and have the next great idea. And yet you have to be constantly thinking like an insurgent, like the innovator who's coming in from... How do you do that now with a company that's not just so big, but so distributed?
So that's a huge challenge. And, you know, we actually use that language internally, talking about a need for insurgency, but while still benefiting and taking advantage of the benefits of scale, and designing the different organizational systems to enable that takes a really deliberate and thoughtful approach. So a couple things that we try to do is we try to preserve agency, you know, in the leaders that are either running product teams, you know, or the local markets, et cetera, to help empower them to adapt based on what they think is right, and as well as incubating and protecting and shielding longer term risky ideas from the rest of the company that is sort of built a lot of institutional muscle and in doing things a certain way, which in that part of the organization, in our case, it'd be sort of the League of Legends development and publishing organization, needs to keep learning and adapting as well. But if we're experimenting with different forms of media, comics or film or animation or other games that may be on different platforms or really different genres, those require or may require an entirely different approach. And so we have to be very flexible and willing to go explore those things and help everybody understand that that's the case, which again is a challenge, which then leads to a situation where people internally will often be like, well, why are they doing things this way? Or why can't we have exposure or know what's going on? Which again, we think are healthy questions. And you know, while we value transparency internally and constantly talking to the organization about what we're doing and why, from a philosophical perspective, we don't think that it's actually in the best interest of the company for everybody to know what everyone else is doing constantly, because that's impossible. And so that's an interesting challenge to sort of manage as well. But I think being deliberate about those things and enabling everybody to have a voice and ask questions is really important.
You have an unusual blend. You're a location-based entertainment company. You're an attraction company. You're an entertainment company. You're a gaming company. And you're a sports company. Now, you're a lot of different languages you're dealing with. Which piece of that is the core element that you must get right to make all them work?
I think it's a great question. The way we define ourselves is really based on the audience we're trying to serve. And for us, that starts with gamers, core gamers, people who self-identify as wanting to be part of a really deep and engaging intellectual property experience in sort of a gaming community. And we work backwards from building a great relationship with that audience to understand their frame of reference and what they love. And we're fortunate in that we hire and, you know, are people that are sort of members of this community as well. And all the different aspects of the business, whether it's sports or other forms of media, et cetera, are derived to try to serve that audience more effectively. So we build competency to do a better job at connecting with our audience. And we try to acknowledge that oftentimes we have no understanding or any competency at all in these different dimensions. But then we, again, from a learning perspective, try to experiment and grow rapidly to go deliver things that they may really enjoy.
Am I correct in understanding that you tend to hire just gamers for pretty much every function?
We do, yeah. Even in accounting or things that aren't necessarily player-facing, we think they do a better job for Riot if they're gamers.
And do you worry about the spectrum of people that you have, whether it's broad enough?
Yes and no. We think that we do think diversity of thought is incredibly important. We want people to challenge our ideas. We want people to challenge each other's ideas internally. But what we've found is the ability to relate deeply and want the desire to intrinsically, sort of the intrinsic motivation to relate deeply to the audience you're trying to serve is incredibly important. And it's that empathy and sort of passion which creates conviction in individuals to make them willing to buck the status quo or sort of challenge convention. So again, even in accounting as an example, you know, if our internal accountants are arguing with, you know, PwC in North America about why we should, you know, recognize our unspent virtual currency revenue in a particular way, they're way better at doing that if they can explain it tangibly in terms of how it manifests as a player and why that's different from the way GAAP rules are structured. And so our business is oftentimes, it's about making these micro decisions, and the difference between a great decision or a terrible decision in our business is about how that decision impacts our players and our end user. And you only can do that if you can relate to them and want to relate to them.
So my final question is, for me, is interesting. People often say, esports not a sport. So how do you answer that, or do you need to answer that?
Our perspective is, you know, everybody's a critic and everybody's entitled to their own opinion, and you know, to the extent that it's bar talk or water cooler talk to argue about esports or whether it's a sport or not or whatever, we think that even the conversation's great. But we tend to not really focus on or think it's that even that relevant, because what we know is that millions of people around the world love to play the games, millions of people love to watch, millions of people are fans of the players and, you know, the incredible talent that is involved in the scene. And it's a big business now that is supporting thousands of people are outside just in the ecosystem. And, you know, that we think is really what matters. And we think we'll leave it to history to determine what, you know, it's defined as.
Thank you, Mark.
Yeah, thank you guys.